All over the world, we're hearing the same thing. It sounds something like this.
And the hottest ticket in rock today. We investigate the phenomenon that is U2. Good evening. Later we bring you a report hop from U2's triumphant US tour. Who found the market for Ireland's outstanding play in America, but who, unlike so many of their compatriots, have chosen to continue living at home. They're among the top contributors to this country's export earnings, and Pat Kenny has been finding out why.
This is Boston, Massachusetts, the Irish-American capital of the United States. If you stop a passerby here and ask for a name, you'll probably get an O'Mahony, a Murphy, a McGrath, or even a Kennedy. But their view of Ireland is a little bit green, a little bit quaint. Over the last three nights, though, more than 50,000 people from this area have been paying sometimes very big money indeed to catch a glimpse of the real Ireland. They've been seeing what Time magazine has described as the hottest ticket in rock, because you too are on tour in America.
Now it's springtime for Boston on BCN.
WBCN Boston.
Boston is a sort of homecoming for the band. Carter Allen of WBCN is the disc jockey who first played a U2 record in the United States.
BCN, how you feeling? Got the good folks at 536-8000. Lots of U2 requests for this U2 Saturday. It's the very first day that U2 is in town. They'll be doing three sold-out nights at the BCN Show in Worcester. And if you didn't get tickets, I'm happy to say that...
It was no overnight success. The band dates back to 1977. U2 is Bono, real name Paul Hewson, lead vocalist and chief lyricist. The Edge, or Dave Evans, lead guitar and musical innovator. At the heart of the rhythm section, drummer Larry Mullen, and on the bass, Adam Clayton, all friends from their school days. Paul McGuinness, often called the fifth member of the band, came on board as manager in 1978. Many of the 18,000 who will come each night to the Centrum Auditorium in Worcester, Massachusetts, claim a U2 concert is almost a spiritual experience.
It was one of the most moving and uplifting experiences that I've ever had in my life. I cried the whole thing.
There's a show, there's more than just the music speaking to you. There's the audience participation.
It's like he brings everybody together, and it's not like everybody's in their own little world like at most concerts. Everybody's really together, and I just thought it was really good.
And I think there was an article, it might have been in Time magazine, where they made a reference to this is what church should be like, and it's true.
This is freedom. Look at these people together here. We are together. We are for each other.
Oh, yeah.
For the Reverend Martin Luther King, this is pride in the name of love.
Most of these fans were not even born when Martin Luther King was killed, but their response to this anthem is undeniably real and heartfelt.
That song originally, it was out of a sense of yearning almost for our own country and for the Northern Irish situation, that there wasn't a Martin Luther King for Northern Ireland. And I know, you know, that's something I don't really want to get into in this interview, but really, that was where we were coming from on that song. On the subject of Northern Ireland, I think we've said it all in Sunday Bloody Sunday, one of our most famous songs. And really, I don't think there's anything more for us to say on that subject. It's, you know,
it's on a lot of your heroes in the songs would be the working class heroes, the poor people of Central America or the blacks in the southern states, or the oppressed people of Northern Ireland or Southern Ireland, the poor unemployed. Yet you yourselves are, I suppose, middle class Dublin. Do you find any paradox or contradiction there?
No, I don't at all. You know, a songwriter writes about what he sees around, not necessarily relating purely to first-hand experience, but everything. It could be, you know, we'd write a song about whatever. The fact that it happens to be, in the cases of the songs you're pointing out, songs about civil rights problems in America or violence in Northern Ireland, that just means that this is something we feel strongly about.
But U2 is about business too. Don Lowe is the promoter for the Greater Boston area.
How many nights do you think they could fill this stadium?
I think that they could comfortably sell probably a full week of seven nights of arena dates here in the Boston market without too much difficulty.
And is it your choice or their choice not to
Their choice. Oh, clearly our choice would be to play a week, stay a month. But no, it's their choice.
What is the gross for a three-day date like this?
It should be somewhere in the $600,000 range, $600,000 to $700,000.
That's the gross take.
That's the gross, yes.
So you two have been good for you.
They've been very good for not only us, but everyone in this country who's been involved with presenting their concerts.
This band is different. Those who wait at the hotel know that hysteria is not a technique which impresses you two. They know that Bono prefers to talk. The extrovert on stage is almost shy.
I know, don't be embarrassing me.
The relationship with the fans seems to extend beyond music, a bond of common concerns and common interests.
I suppose we maintain that bond by putting them first. You know, after each show, we assess whether it's been a good show or not. And I suppose we're quite insecure about our performances, about our abilities live, and maybe that's what keeps the standard of our performances quite high. And that's really, I suppose, why we have such a loyal following. People come back to the shows because they can sense a commitment coming from stage to performance and keeping up, you know, that standard.
One of the main aspects of Bono and the band, but Bono especially, because he's responsible for a lot of the lyrics, most of the lyrics, is that they are a reflection of his feelings. They are Bono. They are passionate. It's not Bono playing a part. It is Bono. Bono feels these things. And for that reason, it's essential that he writes about these political problems or events or injustices, because this is what he feels. And the fans know this. Fans realize this. They're smart.
I think he's strong enough sometimes when it comes to his own country. He doesn't speak clearly about Northern Ireland. This is the first time I've known them since 78, 79. I've been to Ireland like several times. And that's the first time I've ever heard him mention Belfast or Sunday Bloody Sunday.
You know, they're not superstars that people put up on pedestals. They're just regular people. And they're playing their music. They're doing exactly what they want to do. They've never conformed to commercial music to make money for the purpose of making money. They've just been doing what they dearly love to do.
I think they're saying what needs to be said. You know, no one else is saying it, but they're
you know, making it known to the world. And
it's
needs
not popular to
be,
say it.
Right.
Right.
They're bringing up issues that no one else would have known about unless they had said it.
Well, the governor of Massachusetts is going to be a candidate for the Democratic nomination for the presidency in 1988. Is he likely to listen to sentiments like this? Because all of you will be potential voters.
I don't know that they're going to be able to reach him.
I doubt it.
Some people might say that a band from outside this country shouldn't really come in here and start talking about your own domestic politics.
It's hard to stand in the woods and see the clearings. Today, Americans, they don't see, they're too isolated. We don't get the continental view that Europeans get. Because see, we only get one influence, America. We have no France, we have no, you know, influences from other parts of the world. America's all by itself. You look to the north, what Canada doesn't give you much. And Mexico is third world practically.
They only give you
and Central America. Americans don't even know the geography of Central America. If it wasn't for people coming in from other parts of the world and telling us what we're doing there, we'd never know.
Interest and commercial success, I would say that they'd have to be in the top four or five. I mean, it's very difficult to say, but clearly there are very few acts I would feel comfortable putting ahead of them. They're certainly in the very top level of three to five acts in the world.
They give you that same great rock and roll show, but then they give you the message as well. And you walk out being genuinely touched. And that's why I'll go back again tonight. And that's why I see so many faces there for three nights. These people stood out in line, not for one night's tickets. They stood out waiting for 3 days' tickets. And we'll probably see them in New York City as well. So it's the emotion that you get from a U2 show, which takes it into that next realm that you don't get from so many shows. There's only a handful, maybe Bruce Springsteen. Well, I know Bruce Springsteen is one, but only a handful of artists can do that.
I would say that if it were a stock you could invest in, I would say that in this popular music business where things tend to disappear quickly, this is the other side. This is really the blue chip, like a Bruce Springsteen. And again, because of the strength of live appearance, they should be here for a long, long time. I would say that this is an act that's going to be around for 10 years more. It's an act that's going to be here for a long time.
The seal was put on their success 2 weeks ago when Time magazine had the band on the cover and described them as the hottest ticket in rock. Only a handful of performers have achieved the distinction of a Time cover. For rock fans, a more important accolade is the current cover of Rolling Stone. U2 have made that coveted cover twice. U2 give much of the credit for their success to their manager, their mentor, their friend, Paul McGuinness. He has ensured that the four will never have to worry about money for the rest of their lives.
Have you any idea at this stage what the gross for the tour will be?
I've got a very good idea, but that information, I'm afraid, is privileged, because remember always that you two are my clients and these are their affairs we're talking about, and I wouldn't be at liberty to give you figures.
We would be talking in hundreds of millions, though, would we not? Gross.
Hundreds of millions gross? Well, I mean, the gross sale of the records, I mean,
it's big money.
It's big money. Yeah.
What happens to that money? I mean, there are obviously those in Ireland who are going to imagine that it's buried in the Cayman Islands or in offshore accounts all around the world. What actually happens to the money?
Well, the basis of Irish taxation is extremely simple. If you're an Irish resident, you pay tax in Ireland on your worldwide income, and you're not allowed to have overseas deposits, and we don't. Obviously, we don't pay any more tax than we have to, and we are vigorous in protecting ourselves, if you like. But I think everyone knows all our businesses are based in Ireland. That's where we pay all our tax.
Would you say you're a significant contributor to the Exchequer?
I would think so. Sure. Yeah.
The entourage of 60 who put the show together are largely Irish. They're super efficient, and they have to be, because it costs...